Namaste. Welcome you all for this session of Virtual Implant Expo. First of all, let me welcome our respected speaker for the session, Dr. Nitin Ahuja, and all the participants to Virtual Implant Expo that is being organized by Dentist Channel Online. I'm Dr. Ashwin from Bengaluru, who will be moderating this session on tilted implantology using tilt technique. It is my privilege and honor to introduce the speaker for the session, Dr. Nitin Ahuja. Sir graduated from MM University in the year 2005, and the following year he joined his master's in oral and maxillofacial surgery and completed the degree from KLE University, Belgaum in 2006. He further did his fellowship in cleft and craniofacial surgery from Germany, and he has completed his advanced implantology training from Israel and Spain. He is an international speaker for zygomatic and pterygoid implants and conducts numerous workshops on the same in different parts of the world. So today, here in the online platform, we are joined with Dr. Nitin Ahuja, and we are privileged to listen to him. He has also certified a mentor for zygomatic implants from Norris Medical. So with this, I hand over the show to you, sir. Sir, may I request you to kindly take over the session for this Virtual Implant Expo Session 6. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Hi, good evening all. And thank you, Dr. Ashwin, for the introduction. And it's indeed my pleasure to be at this platform because this is something which has happened for the first time. And in this Corona times, I think these lectures, these events, these workshops are the one things which keeps us going. Now, this is about a technique which is for tilted implantology, and I have developed this technique by the name TILT. Now, the problem was because, as Dr. Ashwin said, I was too much into zygomatic and pterygoid, and what used to happen whenever I used to lecture, there are doctors who were really interested in this science, but there are doctors who want to start their journey in tilted implantology. So what I felt that without clearing the basics about tilted implantology, it is not fair on my part as a speaker or as a mentor to, you know, every time just directly speak on the pterygoids and the zygomatic implants. And for that same reason, I have developed my own technique, the tilt technique. And this covers everything which any doctor, any dentist, any practicing implantologist, if he's really interested in shifting from the conventional implants to tilted implants. So what are the key points which he should focus on so that the understanding of tilted implantology becomes easy? So my presentation is for today is all about this tilted implantology and my journey, like what was the need for me to deviate from a conventional all on 4 to this all on 10. I always prefer to place 6 implants in the maxilla and 4 in the mandible, and that's the reason we say our technique as all on X with the usage of pterygoids and zygomatic implants wherever they are necessary. Okay, in all the cases, I don't recommend zygomatic implants. So this is what we are going to learn. When to go for a conventional all on 4, when to go for pterygoids, and when to go for zygomatic implants. So without wasting much of the time, let's start our today's presentation, which is on the tilt technique. Now, one thing is that this is basically for, we are focusing today for the atrophic jaw, atrophic maxilla. And we'll be talking a lot about the zygomatic implants, which I use that design, which you just saw in the video. This is my design, which I prefer for the pterygoids. And this is a very special implant for the anterior part, which is known as the cortical two-piece implant, which I use from Norris. So I use these three different designs to rehabilitate my atrophic maxilla.
Dr. Nitin, sorry to disturb you. You need to share your screen. We are not able to see your screen. Thank you.
Yes. Just 1 minute.
No problem, sir. Hello, participants. A warm welcome to you. Till the time Dr. Nitin fixes the screen. Okay. All right. There you go. Perfect. Yeah. Let's have a conversation a little later. Thank you, Dr. Nitin.
Okay, yeah, thank you again, Ruben. So I was talking about the designs of implants which I prefer for my atrophic maxilla. So the first implant which is my favorite is obviously the zygomatic implant, and this is the kind of design which I prefer for my zygomatic implant, and it is not a fully surface treated implant. This is the design which I use a lot for my pterygoids. This is also having a polished neck which is around 5 mm, and for the anterior part, and because there are sometimes very narrow ridges, so I prefer this design, which is a two-piece cortical implant design. And my cases are always complete by the usage of multi-unit abutments. Okay, we don't believe in cast-able abutments. Whenever we do full mock jaw, we always use these design of implants along with the multi-unit abutment and give a screw-retained prosthesis for our patient. And when you see this x-rays, as I mentioned earlier, we always prefer 6 implants in the maxilla, and these are the location how the implants are being placed in the maxilla. And for the mandible, we prefer to place the intermental foramen region like a convention all on 4 technique. Okay, so now when you are starting your journey of tilted implantology, okay, there are many confusions because, you know, each and every company is into multi-unit abutments. You know, they say that our implants are best when you want to do it all on 4 technique. But the thing is that as a doctor, we should know where one company is standing differently from the other conventional company. Okay, so we'll be talking about the implant companies which I prefer if I have to do an implant which I'm tilting, what kind of materials they use to manufacture their implant and multi-unit abutments, because the stresses are not like a conventional implant. Then the design of implants, which actually we just discussed in our first slide, the types of implants, and about the multi-unit abutment. So let's see about the implant company. Now, the most commonly used implants are of Noble Biocare and Straumann. So now Straumann has a technique by the name ProArch, which is again just a variation of all on 4, in which they also advise placement of 4 implants. And then you have another company by the name Breden. They have a fast and fixed system. Now Straumann, they did not have zygomatic and pterygoid implants, but last month they have introduced their zygomatic implants, I think for the UK market. And this is the kind of design which they have introduced. And I really like this design compared to other implants which were available, because as I said, I prefer to use an implant which is at least 60 to 70% of the implant which is polished and not surface treated. But I don't think as of now it is available in India. Then you have BioHorizons. They have a technique by the name Teeth Express. Now they don't have a zygomatic, but they do have a pterygoid implant. And even they have introduced this year only. They were not having that before. But the only problem, they are not having a zygomatic implant. So why I am focusing on this? Because I would really prefer someone to use one company's implant in one patient. Okay, I don't want you to place one company implant in the pre-maxilla, then other company's implant in the posterior maxilla, and then the third company's implant in the zygoma. Okay, so why I'm trying to give you this information is that if your x-ray, you know, defines the usage of zygomatic and pterygoid, then you know, you will be in a position to understand that, you know, this company has this kind of implant or not. Now coming to Noble Biocare. Noble Biocare, everyone knows they are into the market since past 55 years, and they are the pioneers in zygoma. They also introduced zygoma in late 1990s. So they have almost each and every implant length starting from 6 mm up till 60 mm. Okay, they don't have a dedicated design for zygoma, for the pterygoid, but the design what they are having for around 20-22 mm of length of their implant, they are very apt for the pterygoid region. And then this is the third company which I prefer, which is Norris Medical, and they have these designs. If you see in the middle part, if you see on the middle side, you have this cortical, then you have this zygomatic, and this is the pterygoid. And for the lower, it depends what kind of implant you want to use, depending the quality and quantity of bone available. Now, the second point is what kind of material they are using to manufacture their implant components as well as their implant body. Now, these are what I found out in the catalogs of different companies. Like this one, I found it in an Dentsium, that this is the comparison of a grade 4 titanium with grade 5. So they are making their implant in grade 4, but they have introduced new abutments made up of grade 5. Coming to Noble Biocare, they are making their regular platform and white platform implants in grade 4. But what they make it for their 3mm thin implant is a different material. Mostly it should be grade 5, but they have actually differentiated from this grade 5. So they are adding some kind of alloy to it. And if you see, the mechanical, the elastic limit is 750 MPa compared to a grade 4 titanium. And then this is from the Italian company. So what I'm trying to say is that when you are tilting your implants beyond 30 degree, okay, up till 25 degree, all these implants are meant to take the load, the crestal load, which comes after placing of your tilted abutments. But when you are tilting your abutments beyond 25 to 30 degree, okay, always prefer to use an implant, an abutment, which is made up of grade 5 titanium. Okay, design of an implant. Now this is Noble Active, this is Norris Cortical, this is Strawman, this is BioHorizon, this is a conventional Israeli implant. So whenever you are placing an implant for tilted implantology, almost 99.99%, we always do immediate loading. And for immediate loading, the primary criteria is to get a very, very high, good primary stability. So I always prefer to use these kind of designs. I don't prefer to use the passive thread designs, which are commonly available with some of the Korean companies. Okay, types of implants, your company should be able to provide you with cortical, zygomatic, pterygoids, hybrid surface, because it really makes a difference when we are talking about the longevity of that prosthesis. Okay, multi-unit abutments. So any company who is actually providing you up to 45 degree, that according to me is a very, very good company. Okay, if your company does not have a multi-unit abutment beyond 30 degree, then in some situations you will actually see, which I will show you in my case studies, that you are somewhere compromising the case. Okay, so if your company is providing you with a 45 degree, that according to me is a good company to start with. Okay, now the philosophy of tilt. The philosophy of tilt is based on these four things, which is the bone, the implant, the abutment, and the prosthesis. And then there are various points which we'll be discussing under these four main headings. So in bone, we prefer to use a native bone and we don't advise bone grafting. Okay, then what are the biomechanical implant positions? So we prefer to place implants in the biomechanical areas, which helps in the dispersion of loads. The cortical stabilization, we advise a bicortical stabilization. In the heading of implants, we prefer to use a grade 23, which is even a purest form of grade 5 titanium. I prefer to use a hybrid surface implants. I prefer to use a polished collar of from 2mm, 4mm or 5mm, dependingly what kind of design I am using. Then what is the minimum diameter and length? And what is an ideal angulation of tilted implantology, we'll be discussing in the upcoming slides. In the abutments, we just prefer to use multi-unit abutments, because when we use a multi-unit abutment, we are following a concept which is the one abutment, one-time concept. Then in the prosthesis, we don't believe in cantilevers. Unlike your conventional all-on-four cases, which I have seen, which I have done, and I have really burned my fingers into that. So the main idea is that you should not have a cantilever and your prosthesis should have a cross-arch stabilization. I don't believe in doing a denture temporization for the initial phases also. Then what kind of prosthesis are advisable? And the main important point, which I always find myself, you know, people, doctors asking questions that, you know, doctor, in what is the minimum number of days in which or the maximum number of time which we can take to immediate load it. Okay, we'll be discussing that, whether you should do it in 24 hours, whether you should do it in 72 hours, or you can take that time forward. So how does it affect? We'll be discussing that. Now, the first point that, as I told you, I don't do bone grafting much in my full mouth cases. Almost, again, 100% of my cases, the implants I place in the native bone. Okay, and based on the literature, the review the survival rate of implant is lower for a grafted maxilla as compared to a non-grafted maxilla. Okay, and these are the two studies which have proved my point, which I'm trying to tell. And this is the QR code of the latest study. You can just open your camera and automatically when you focus on this QR code, automatically they will take you to the study. And thus that study has also compared implants placed in the grafted maxilla with the non-grafted. And a statistically difference was seen because of the success rate of 75% in the grafted compared to 84% success rate in the non-grafted group. Okay, so then what are the advantages? You know, why I am saying you not to place an implant in a grafted bone? Because there is no donor side morbidity. If you believe in a lot of autogenous bone, then you don't have to take that bone. You have a reduced treatment time. We don't wait for our patients to, you know, have a healing which needs to take place, because we are not doing any kind of grafting. Less number of visits and discomfort. All our cases we finish within 1 week. Okay. And after that, and after the first day of surgery, we never inject our patient again. I would not say the fourth point, immediate functional loading. So I am not saying that every time you have to do, if you are really, because this is what I have been doing initially, you know, when I was not immediate loading guy. So I always used to place implant and then wanted to see, you know, whether it takes up or not. So if the best part is that with this technique, if you want to wait for 3 months, 6 months, or for any reason you are not getting a prime stability, it's your first case, second case, the bone is very soft. So there is, you know, no need to do a loading. But yes, this is a very, very important point when you are consulting your patient. This is always a possibility. Okay, but if you are not comfortable, you can definitely delay. And there's a reduced cost because you have really reduced the cost of bone grafts, membrane, and you have really reduced the chair time. Okay, so it is very, very cost effective for the patient, which brings in more patient to your practice. Second, the grade of titanium use. Okay. So now this is the picture which I have taken from the catalog of BioHorizon, and even they are made up of grade 5 titanium. And in my technique, we use a variation of grade 5, which is having even less percentage of oxygen and carbon. And it is known as grade 23 titanium or grade 5 ELI, extra low interstitial, which is having more corrosion resistant and better biocompatibility. If you wish to read further about difference of commercially pure titanium and grade 4, grade 5, grade 23, then this is a study. You can again scan the QR code and it will take you directly to this study, so that it will be clear in your mind that what are the advantages of having a grade 5 or a grade 23 titanium over a grade 2 or a grade 4 titanium, which there are many companies who are making their implants with. Hybrid surface implant. So as I said, I don't use an implant which is totally surface treated, and I sometimes use it as a tissue level implant, but there are many instances where I have used it as a bone level implant also. Okay. Now, what are the advantages? The advantages obviously is that it reduces the periopathogens on the crestal part, which avoids any peri-implantitis or the chance of peri-implantitis, which eventually leads to a bone loss. But yes, there is always, whenever we try to portray a good thing about one technique or one feature, there are always some kind of controversies. And the controversy is that a polished collar implant will always have a bone loss. Yes, you will always have a bone loss, whether it is a polished or it is a rough surface, if your load dissipation is not correct. Then you will have a bone loss, whether it is a polished or a rough. But yes, I agree that there are more chances of having a bone loss in a polish because the surface area is less. But if you see now, this implant from here to here is a polished, and this one from here to here, it is polished. And this implant is also polished because this is the bone level. This is also a polish from this part. Now, this is a 2-year follow-up, and you see that the bone level is intact at the same level on which we have placed an implant 2 years back. So if you are having a good load dispersion, you will not have a bone loss. Okay, but the advantage is that even if you are having a bone loss after 2 mm, even if there is a recession, you really don't have to do any invasive procedure. because the polished surface is the surface which is going to get exposed and not the rough surface. So you don't have to do anything apart from just telling your patient your regular routine follow-up visits. Okay, now this is a very important question. What is the diameter, length and angulation of tilt? Now, what I have seen is that doctors placing a 3.5 mm, a 3.3 mm for their tilted implantology. So what is going to happen is that eventually after, you know, maybe a 3 years of function, there is always a chance of fracturing of the neck of an implant. Okay. And that's the reason if you see the kind of implants, what I use, whether it is a cortical, whether it's a pterygoid, whether it's a pterycoid or a zygoma, they only comes in a diameter which is more than 4 or 4.2 mm. You don't have these implants coming in 3.3 or a 3.5 mm. Okay. Because this is the minimum diameter which I always advise when you where you are tilting your implant. Okay. Okay. And this is the load which you can see the biomechanics. So on a implant which is thinner, you will see more load compared to an implant which is around 4.2. You will see a less load which is there on the crestal part. And this is the study. You can scan and go through this study. And now there are doctors who always argue why you have to tilt your implant, why the company what you are using manufactures the multi-end abutments up to 52 and 60 degree. So what I tell you, don't worry about the angulation in a full mouth case. Okay, when you are placing 4 or 6 implants, believe me, it does not matter whether you have tilted your implant to 50 degree or not. Because what matters, and this is kind of a landmark study by the doctor, the conclusion is that from a biomechanical point of view, the position of the coronal end of the implant is more important rather than the implant is tilted or not. By this, what he meant to say is that you should always try to reduce your cantilever. Try to make your implant more posterior. It does not matter what angulation you have placed your implant with, but what matters is that how less is your cantilever, or if you have totally avoided the cantilever. And that is the reason I told you that, you know, having a 45 degree multi-end abutment is very important, because up till 50, 55 degrees, if you have angled your implant, your 45 degree multi-end abutment can take that implant back into the position where you don't have an undercut cut, and you can have a very, very nicely fitting screw retained prosthesis. Okay. And as I said, failure of an implant is not a complication. Okay. What is a complication is fracture of an implant. So managing these cases are very difficult. Now, if you see, we have tilted this implant, this one at 45 degree, and by using a 45 degree multi-end abutment, we have reduced any cantilevers which might happen in this case. Okay. So angulation up till 45 degree, there is no worries. Okay. You can definitely go for an implant. And I am using that from past 5-6 years without any case in which my multi-unit or my implant neck has fractured. Okay. Now the biomechanical implant positions. So why zygoma? I always have this question. Doctor, if we can do 3 implants, if not 4 in the premaxilla, and we add 2 implants in the pterygoid. So why there is a need of zygoma? So now zygomas are actually reserved for very special cases where either you have a bigger pontic between your pterygoid and your last distal most implant. Okay. If this pontic length is more than 3 teeth, yes, you require a zygoma. But yes, why you need it? Because if you see, now these are the 3 buttresses. If you see, this is the nasal buttress. Okay. Then this is the zygomatic buttress. So if you see, zygoma takes away around 65% of the load, and then it dissipates the load to the frontal and the temporal bone. So when you add a zygomatic implant, it actually takes away the 60% of the load which is coming onto your prosthesis. And the third buttress is the pterygo. So in my technique, I always advise to engage the nasomaxillary, the zygomaticomaxillary and the pterygomaxillary. Okay. And that's the reason if someone asks me why you place tilted implant, to my answer is that I always place straight implants, because these are the areas and this is how the forces are being transmitted into the maxilla. And that's the reason this is the way to place an implant which in which the patient is having a very, very atrophic and or a very soft bone. Now, this is for a dentate patient. Forget about an implant patient. Now, if you see, you will see this more stress going towards the zygomatic. Okay, that is the reason. And when you add a zygomatic bone, it helps in taking away the stress in whole of your processes. And that is the reason the success rate of a case in which you have placed zygoma is close to 99%, which is not there in your conventional 6 implants which you place for your full jaw. Okay, so that is the reason. If you really don't want any failures for a maxilla, just try to add a zygoma and see the wonderful results which it can give it to your patient. Now, bicortical stabilization. So now automatically when you do a zygoma, a pterygoid or a nasal, which was first time given by Linco, Brennemark, Linco and Tulis, and or nasal implant engagement or the nasal floor engagement given by Brennemark and Mallow. So on the website, official website of ICOI, it is written that when you do a bicortical stabilization, it can reduce the maximum stress in the superior cortical bone. So it takes away the stress from the crestal bone towards the basal bone. And that's the reason you will see less crestal bone loss when you are placing an implants with bicortical stabilization. Okay. Now, one abutment, one time concept. As I told you, we actually have not thought of this concept, but what we were only using is the multi-unit abutments. But when you do multi-unit abutments on the time of surgery, you're automatically following a concept which is one abutment one time, which means when you place the abutment, after that you don't remove this abutment. So what are the advantages that it gives you? It gives you a very good buco integration along with your osseo integration, and it creates a tight seal for the implant and prevents your bacteria to go into that area, into your implant junction, and start any peri-implantitis. Okay. Now, a study which was done by Abrahamson, he has concluded that if you open and close, you know, your healing caps, your impression post, your jig trial, metal trial. So, if you remove your abutments for more than 4 times, there is a 2 mm loss of mucosa and the crestal bone. Okay, so when you do your case with multi-unit, you are following a concept of one abutment one time, and there is a chance that you try to save this crestal bone and the thickness of your mucosa. Eighth point is that no cantilever. So when you place the pterygoids, so one thing, the best thing what happens is that there are no cantilevers. But if you imagine the same case, if I do it with doing my all on 4. Now, if you see, this is my last implant and my mandible is coming here, which means I have to give a prosthesis by having at least 5 or maybe 10 to 15 mm cantilever. Okay, which is dangerous for the prosthesis and for the patient. And when you add these pterygoids, the beauty is that there are no cantilevers. And this is again a finite element studies which has proved that when you place an implant with just a 10 mm cantilever and around 150 newtons of force, you can see the stress being generated at this part. Compared to another study in which they have tilted their implant and just what they did is just avoided the cantilever, the forces being the same and you are not seeing any stresses. And that's the reason when you place an implant with no cantilever, you will find a success rate which is close to 100%. Keeping the other forces, in controlled manner. But what I can assure you that there are very less chances of failures when you do a case like that. And the best part, you can give your patients a second molar to second molar smile. So I'm not saying that we always try to give, but the thing is that if the patient is having lower prosthesis or a lower natural teeth up till 7 and upper was a terminal dentition, and you extract all the teeth and give a prosthesis which is maybe 6-6 or 5-5, then the patients are not happy. So they want their 7-7 prosthesis, and after giving this kind of prosthesis, our patients were always happy with the kind of rehabilitation we have given for them. And this is the importance of a second molar, that it helps in having 20% of the total food platform area. Okay. and the type of processes. So now many doctors are doing the denture temporization, and this is a study which shows that if you do a denture temporization, you can again see the stresses which are being transmitted when you do a denture temporization compared to a metal to acrylic hybrid process in which the stresses are again reduced compared to the one in which you are having a denture temporization. Okay, so we don't prefer that. We always prefer to have a metal bar or a metal framework inside our acrylic processes. Now, a very important, a time in hand. Now, these are the two studies. They are the QR codes. You can go with it. And so this is the weakest part. Okay, from your second week up till your sixth week. So, which means that up till 10 days also, if you are giving prosthesis to your patient, there is no harm in that. I do routinely that. I generally prefer to give it on between the 7th to 10th day. And as I said, I'm doing it from past 5-6 years with no implant, which was failing in that initial 3 months time for your osseointegration. Okay. So there are many options that you can do. When you follow the TIL technique, you can do the teeth in 3 hours. So if my patient is a denture wearer from past, say, 10, 15 years, okay, in those patients, I do denture temporization because their forces, bite forces are not intact. You can do teeth in 6 hours by doing interval welding. You can do teeth in 24 hours. Like next day, you can do a metal to acrylic prosthesis by doing a Bombay bridge. Or you can do it in 72 hours by doing a conventional hybrid prosthesis, what you were doing generally for your all-on-4 cases. Now, how to decide when to go for all-on-4, when to go for all-on-6, and when to go for all-on-8? Now, a very simple classification that you have anterior premaxilla, a premolar area, and a molar area. When you have bone in all three areas, okay, you will go for conventional 6 implants. When you have bone in zone 2 and zone 1, you will do all-on-4. When you don't have bone in the premolar, you will add a zygoma implant. Okay, so this is known as all-on-4 doing zygoma. And when you don't have bone in this part, then you do a quad zygoma. So you will place one implant in zone 1, zygoma, and another in zone 2. So it's very simple. Let's see your cases. When you have bone, you can place 6 to 8 implants. When you have bone in zone 1 and zone 2, you can do an all-on-4 kind of technique. When you have bone only in zone 1, only in anterior, then you can do an all-on-4, a hybrid all-on-4 with 2 zygoma. And when you don't have any bone in that premaxilla also, then you will do a case which is known as quad zygoma. Okay? Okay, but then what about the pterygoids and the transnasal and the vomer implants? Okay, cases like this, what we will be doing. So there was, so we have actually did a second part of the classification. We have added some positions. Okay, cases like this were not covered in the old classification. Okay, so if you see, we have engaged the orbital floor also. So this is the classification which I have developed for TILT. That you have these 6 areas for engagement. You have area 1, area 2, area 3, same. Then you have the area 4, which is your pterygoid. Then you have area 5, which is the zygoma. And then area 6 for your transnasal or nasalis implant. Okay? So you always see an OPG and see whether you have these areas or not. So let's see how you place implants in these areas. Like you have if I'm placing, as I told you, I prefer these implants with the smooth collar. So this is how we place implants in this part. In zone 2, we place like this. When you have in molars, you place, obviously you will place 6 implants. When you have it in pterygoid, so you place an implant like this, fibropterygoid. This is how it is in place. And for those who really want to understand, you should not place implant above this line. Okay. Anything in this zone is a safe zone. So this is how the pterygoids are being placed. And then if you want placing a zygoma, this is how the zygoma looks on an OPG. And if you don't want to place a zygomas and pterygoids, you follow a company which is more having the lateral nasal implant. So this is the nasalis implant. You can place an implant like this, going passing through the sinus from here and engaging the nasal floor from that part. Okay. this is how it has been placed. So it goes from the sinus from here to here. You can see it. And then it engages the nasal, lateral nasal flow. Okay, now we'll see the cases, how this technique was evolved. So this was a case, you will see that there is no bone anywhere more than 3 mm, 3.7 mm. Okay, so we extracted all the teeth. This is the conventional way. So I use the cortical implant. You can see that. So 4 implants placed. Okay. And this is normally, this is the hybrid prosthesis given on the third day. Okay. Now what I did not see, that there is a lower arch, which is a natural dentition. Okay. So what happened after 3 years? My distal most implant failed because there was a cantilever. So we placed another implant with the 45 degree multi-joint abutment. We did one side pterygoid and one side we did a smaller implant. And then we have given this prosthesis. The best part, that this prosthesis has 14 teeth. Okay. Okay. Now if you see, this has a 14 teeth compared to 6 to 6. This is a second molar to second molar rehab. Another case, those who want to do a flapless. So in this, you have bone in zone 1, zone 2, and zone 4. So what we did a CT scan and an OPG. So the implants were being placed. Okay, all implants you will see at the 45 newtons of torque, minimum stability. So these are the implants in the distal or the premolar area. Okay, both the sides. This is the pterygoid implant, a special design for the pterygoid implant. If you see, again, you get a very good high torque of more than 45 newtons. So both the sides, it has been placed and you can see at least a 45 newtons of torque, which was achieved. Okay, we did the ISQ of all the 6 implants, which is above 71 and 60 in some cases. Okay, 6 multi-joint abutments placed, flapless case. Okay, taken an impression. This is normal lab step, so I'll just go through. Okay. And this is the Bombay bridge, which we have given the next day to the patient. Okay. The profile change. This is the immediate OPG of the patient. And we will see the CT scan. So if you see, we have engaged the nasal floor. This is what I was talking. Okay. Even here, you will see that we have engaged the floor. And this is just engaging. This is just by going above by maybe around 1 mm. Okay, the pterygoids towards the medial pterygoid plates or between the 2 pterygoid plates, which is known as the pterygoid fossa. Okay, this is the CT scan. You can see it is lying in the perfect position for the patient. Okay, this is how you did. And then this is our last case for today, in which we have done zygomatic. She's a patient of ectodermal dysplasia. Okay, this was the X-ray which came to me. If you see, nowhere there is any bone in which you can place any kind of conventional implant. You can see that there is no width available anywhere. Okay. So you can see on this is the other side. So two options, either do a full mouth bone grafting or you can do this case by doing a zygomatic implant. So these were the positions. We just planned digitally. We did not make any stent. So we could see that you can place 2 implants very nicely or you can do a quad zygoma very easily for this case. So we did all our pre-operative evaluation. These are just the markings, the pre-op picture. So if you see, this is just the flap reflection for a zygoma. Okay, like what you do for your sinus lift, the same amount of flap reflection we did it for our zygomas. There are 2 positions which are drawn for our zygomatic. Okay. So we did all the marking. This is just the drilling protocol. And these are the diamond drills used to expose your sinus membrane. And then these are the drills to enter the zygomatic. And you see that this is the implant all polished. Okay. This is all polished. And from here it is entering the zygomatic bone. Okay, from the rough surface implant. So this is the threaded part which is going to be into the bone, and this is the polished part which is going to be beneath the soft tissue.
Excuse me, sir. So the voice is not audible now.
Hello.
Hello.
Dr. Nitin, are you audible? Hello.
Hello, Nitin, sir.
Hi participants, we are trying to fix this issue. We regret for the inconvenience and kindly give us 2 minutes. Thank you.
I'm sure the presentation so far was very good, with lots of information and giving a different perspective of implants and different system of implants that would help a clinician to build his clinical set and deliver better patient care.
Indeed, Dr. Ashwin, thank you so much. I think, participants, we can do a quick introductory session. Can you tell us from which place of this world are you participating, and where are you based? If you are based in India, Delhi, please tell us that you're based in India, Delhi, so that we know that we have a number of participants from all across the world. Let's do a quick introductory session before Dr. Nitin joins in once again.
Yeah, so I have joined. So where did I, you were not able to listen to the presentation. Was it in the quad zygoma case?
The video got paused, sir.
Okay, fine. I'll just do it again. Okay, so this is the post-op CBCT. For our quad zygoma patient, and as I mentioned that we have not used any surgical stent, it is just the planning what we did, and you can see the symmetry which is there on the left and the right side, and so this is achievable under local anesthesia. So what I want to focus is that you know, these cases are not very difficult. I generally advise a general anesthesia for a patient for a quad zygoma. But when patient's mouth opening is very good, you know, you have a good bulk of zygomatic bone, then it is not necessary. So it all depends on the surgical scale of the operator. But the good part is that these type of cases also can be managed on a dental chair. Okay. And then these are some of the cases which we finished in 2019, all full mouth cases using the tilt technique. Okay. And some more of zygomas you will see, because I place a lot of zygomatic in my practice. Okay, so what is the takeaway message? The takeaway message is start doing tilting like me. But jokes apart, that these are the 10 points which you should follow, or which are, I would say, your takeaway home message. That there should not be any cantilevers, okay, when you are doing a full mouth case. You should always try to place 6 implants for the maxilla, because the quality of bone is not good compared to a mandible. Use at least a 4 mm diameter implant when you are tilting more than 45 degree. use a polished collar implant. Now, why I am again and again telling you to use a polished collar implant? Because, you know, in this kind of cases, when you are doing for an atrophic jaw, you always give a hybrid prosthesis for the initial 6 months, or maybe in some cases you do this kind of prosthesis for your as a permanent prosthesis. So there is always a chance of food lodgement there. So if your soft tissue recedes and your rough surface implant gets exposed to the oral mucosa, okay, there's always a chance of peri-implantitis. But with the polished collar, this chance is not there. And, you know, patient can have a better follow-up visits with their doctor because they actually don't have to do any invasive procedure. And that is the reason I advise a polished collar implant. Engaged out of the three buttresses, the nasomaxillary, the zygomaxillary, and the pterygomaxillary, at least try to engage two buttresses, if not three. Use grade 5 or a grade 23 titanium. I have also used once a grade 4, but yes, that case was limited to 30 degrees. As I said, whenever I'm going beyond that, I always prefer to use the grade 5. Choose a company with at least a 45 degree multi-end abutment. Always do a cross arch stabilization. Immediate loading, there is no need to hurry that you have to finish your case in 72 hours. You can do very comfortably in next 7 days. Okay. And tilting has a success rate close to 99%. So, which is better than when you do your conventional 6 axial implants. Okay. So, thank you very much for your time. And these are my details. So, if you have any case, any queries, if I'm not able to answer in this next 15 minutes, you are most welcome. You can follow my page on Instagram where I try to put at least one case daily, okay, or at least one good point which is for a learning. So any, you can contact me on my mobile or my email. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin, sir. It was indeed a wonderful presentation, Dr. Nitin, and you gave us a perspective that we can go with the motto that implants for all, so that we can gift smiles for all the patients, and no patients that visit our clinic will or the colleges will go disappointed that they are not eligible for implants. So this really gave us a ray of hope that we can inculcate all the techniques that you have described, and also not to be loyal to only one system or one method of practicing implants. And we should be broad enough with our knowledge so that we can accommodate every patient in our practice. So that would be for the betterment of our practice as well, and also for the patients who visit us. So I'm sure all our participants have also got inspired that we have a lot more of learning curve to learn all the different techniques, and also learn different techniques for their own betterment in their career. So hearty thanks to you, Dr. Nitin, for this beautiful presentation. It was wonderful seeing all your cases. I'm personally even I'm inspired by all the techniques that you have developed. Thank you, sir, once again from Team Dentist Channel Online. Dr. Sachin Balla has asked a question that in case of placing tilted implants, if implant crosses the sinus and hits the basal bone and engages, does this matter of is this a matter of concern, and in that hollow space within the sinus? So how to manage such situations?
So doctor, so now the old concept was that you should not go into the sinus, but I would not say latest, because people are doing this tilted implantology or transsinus implantology also from past 10-12 years. So now the only thing is that what we need to understand, if the patient is already having a chronic sinusitis, okay, there is always a chance of retrograde infection which can happen, okay. But don't think that placement of your implant can lead to a chronic sinusitis, okay. Because when the doctors started practicing zygomatic implantology from 1990s, the original technique was the placement of zygoma going intrasinus, like from the palatal approach, passing through the sinus and then hitting the zygomatic bone. Okay. And the main thing, the main studies were that what are the incidences of sinusitis. So the incidence of sinusitis post zygomatic implant insertion is 16 to 18%. Okay. But But when they found out in journals of ENT that what is the normal percentage of sinusitis in a healthy individual, like the patients without implants, so the same percentage was also around 16%. Okay, so we cannot pinpoint that the zygoma implant caused this sinusitis, or the patient already had a tendency or was having this kind of sinusitis earlier. So the only, if you ask me, if your sinus is infected, it can always lead to a retrograde infection, but that is the reason I use an implant which is polished collar. Okay.
I hope Dr. Sachin Bala, you're satisfied with sir's answer. So we'll take up next question from Dr. Shilpa Nandini. So she has asked that if initial stability of 45 Newton is not achieved, will you still prefer loading?
Yeah. So here we are not talking about a single implant. We are talking about at least 4 or 6 implants. So there is another thing which is known as the composite torque of an arch. Okay, so the composite torque of an arch means what is the total torque if you add of other 3, 4, or 5 implants, dependingly what, how many number of implants you have used. So if the composite torque is more than 200 newtons, you can always immediately load it. So then this one implant which is having less stability does not have much of a difference. But as I said, in mandible, definitely out of 4, if one is not having, maybe it's having a 25 Newton and other 3 are having 45, you can do it. But maxilla, if you remember, I'm always saying again and again, always try to place 6 implants. It can be 4 in the pre-maxilla, 2 in the pterygoid, or 2 in the pre-maxilla, 2 in the zygoma, and 2 the pterygoid. So in that, your composite torque will always be beyond 250 Newtons and you can always do immediate.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is by Dr. Manoj Kumar. He has asked for the length of implant.
Yeah, so the zygoma implant, it starts only from 30 mm. So you will get it at 30 at the intervals of every 2.5 mm, like 30 mm, 32.5, 35, up till 60 mm. And the pterygoid implants, they come only on four lengths, which is 18 mm, 20, 22 and 25.
Okay, and also regarding the angle of zygomatic implants.
So, if you ask me, maybe 90% of the times I place at 45 degrees. So, if you are placing at 45 degrees, it anyways tells you that you are at a very good location. Maybe in 5%, maybe in 2% of the cases, 52 degree, and 6-7% 30 degree. But 90% of the cases, you will place at 45 degree angulation only.
Okay. And yeah. Then there is another question from Dr. Shilpa. What is the minimum interact space for pterygoid implants?
See, now pterygoids always have a problem. So there is a protocol for pterygoid. The original protocol says that you have to remove the lower third molar. Okay. Or in other ways, if you are having less than 7-8 mm, you have to remove the lower third molar.
Okay. It will be a proper rehabilitation.
A proper, but yes. Generally, doctors, they don't give a teeth over a pterygoid. The pterygoid is used as a terminal abutment, which is just having a support, and the prosthesis they give generally 6-6 only. Okay. I give, in my cases, if you see, you will see a pterygoid and you will always find a tooth below it. But you know, I am getting cases which are too atrophic. So in my cases, I have never faced the problems in which I had a less interact space.
And there is a question from Dr. Devendra. So he asks, what are the prosthodontic complications that you faced while rehabilitating quad zygoma cases?
I think my previous answers will again answer this. So as I said, quad zygoma is for a very, very atrophic jaw. Like you don't have bone even in the pre-maxilla. Okay. So you will always, rather you will find more amount of bone. The space. Which is intera space available. So you will not have this kind of complications in a zygoma. Like if you're doing a case which is ideal for zygoma or a quad zygoma, you will never have less intera space.
Okay.
So and how do I just read a question that how do I, this thing measure the space available. So we always first make a denture. If you have seen a quad zygoma case will always be for a patient who is a denture wearer patient or maybe having a cleft palate or CA. So we always first make a denture. Okay. and then we do our planning, because we want our implants inside the incisal edges of the anterior. So we always try to first make a denture, which is done like with your conventional means, and then we follow the same principles of rehabilitation.
Okay. And there's a good question from Manoj Kumar, that is it possible to implant in cleft palate patient?
Yeah, yes, for sure.
Yeah, so that
because in a cleft palate patient also, or you know, if your ABG has failed in a patient, you will always have an opening or a fistula in those patients. So if you see, as I said, I prefer an implant which is having 70% as a smooth surface or a polished collar. So this design of an implant is apt for a CA patient as well as a cleft lip and palate patient.
Okay, thank you, sir. And then Dr. Anand has asked this question, that when there is enough bone, would you advise tilting or conventional method?
No. Then I will do conventional. As I said, when the bone is available in zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, I will go with conventional.
Conventional. Yes.
Yes.
And then a question from Alka Verma. What is the significance of 45 degrees in the implant? I mean, how is it able to distribute the masticatory forces?
No, it's about where you can take your implant from at the coronal end. Like if you know that you have, I can draw somewhere.
I think you can go to share screen and there's an option for whiteboard.
You cannot start screen share while the other participant is sharing. Maybe because you are sharing, so
I'll stop sharing. You can go.
Okay, so the advantage, like if let's see the, like if this is a mandible, okay, and this is our intermental foramen. Okay, so now if you have a 30 degree, okay, so you know that you will place an implant like this. Okay, so now if your distal most implant fails, Or my company provides me with a 45 degree abutment. So I know that I can take my implant more posteriorly, because I know that with the 45 degree abutment, I can still rehabilitate that patient. Okay. If you will be using your implant, if you will be placing an implant at 45 degree and your company is providing only with a 30 degree multi-end abutment, so then what can happen is that when you place your multi-end abutment, it will be still in this position.
Okay,
because of 45 degree I can come like this, but in 30 degree I can still be away. So the forces which are going to an implant are totally axial by the use of 45 degree. I am not saying that with 30 degree you cannot manage a 45 angulated implant, because your multi-end abutments are like this. Okay, 15 degree they can manage because of this design, but the only thing is that it will still be instead of so if I am placing a 45, it will be in this location, but when you place 30 degree it will be in this location. Okay. So your abutments are like this, so your forces will go like this, and in my case the forces will go like this.
Okay.
So the screw loosening will not happen.
Okay.
If I'm using a 45 degree abutment only. But in your case, you can have a screw loosening, or rather a screw fracture. Because if you see, the screw of a multi-end abutment is very, very small. And that is an advantage of having a 45 degree.
Thank you, sir.